blessing. Amen. You know, we've been talking a lot about miracles these past few Sundays and Wednesdays, and I'm going to kind of stay along those lines. The title, if I was given the title, is Believe in Miracles. Believe in Miracles. Let's go to the Father in prayer. Father God, I just thank you, Lord God, for this word. I thank you, Lord God, that this word would go forth unhindered and without compromise. I thank you, Lord God, that it will accomplish that which you sent it out to in the name of Jesus. I thank you that it will not go on the ears, but I think it will go forth and be a blessing to the hearers. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. You know, I just feel in my heart that it must be time for my breakthrough. Because I've been going through certain things the past couple of weeks, you know, that has really been tested, really been put me to the test. You know, my son that's playing basketball in the NBA right now, you know, he started, you know, he was really progressing, real good. And then all of a sudden, prepared with his word, you know, it's like, you know, anytime you look at a home, they would call him fouls on him. He was just getting in foul trouble, and then it's numbered down a little bit. You know, other things with my other two kids and my family and things that's been going on with my wife, you know, just let me know that my miracle is on the way. I'm at the brink of my miracle. Amen. I looked that word miracle up. It says a wonder or a wonderful thing, an event or effect contrary to the established constitution and course of a thing. It says, or a deviation from the known laws of nature. We know the laws of nature, gravity, relative motion, and things like that. It goes against things like that. A supernatural event. You know, it's beyond human reasoning. You know, man can't explain it because it's the very word of God. You know, and I thought about the woman with the issue of blood. You know, the Bible says that she had an issue of blood for 12 long years. And not only that, she went to the physicians. She went thinking she would get better, but yet she got worse. The Bible says that she spent all she had, all of her resources, trying to get well, trying to go to man. You know how we do, you know. We don't really think God can do it, so we go to man and depend on man, and then we can't do it. Then we consider God. You know, the Bible says she spent all of her resources, but your brother got worse. But somebody told her about the Lord. Somebody told her about Jesus. How he is a healer. He can lay hands on the sick and they will recover. You can receive your miracle from Jesus. And hearing this word, this woman grabbed hold of that word. So she grabbed hold of that word and found out that Jesus was on the way. Jesus was passing through the neighborhood. So the Bible says that this woman gathered herself together and went out. She said, if I could just touch the hem of his garment, if I could just touch the hem of his garment. She didn't say if she could just meet up with it. She didn't say that, you know, if I was to just grab his shoulder. This woman had to build her faith up to believe that if she was just to touch the hem of his garment, she would be made whole. So the Bible says that this woman with the issue of blood pressed through the crowd. You know, because when Jesus comes to town, everybody wants to see Jesus. Jesus is a star. He comes through. The Bible says that a crowd was all around him, thronging him, this and that. But this woman was able to press through the crowd and touch the hem of his garment. You know, I was reading that, and I say that crowd represents the struggles that we going through and have been through. That crowd represents every negative word that has been spoken against you. You're not good enough, you know. have what it takes. Every negative word, a struggle. The crowd represents, you know, generational curses that's been passed down through generation to generation. That's what it represents. And it represents every lie that has been told about you. But the Bible says she pushed through. She pressed through that. And that's what we have to do. We have to press through the crowd to get our miracle, to get our deliverance, to be delivered and set free, you know. Psalm 72 and 18 says, praise the Lord, the God of Israel, who alone does such wonderful things. And we know wonderful things are miracles. Says God alone is the only God that does miracles. You can't go to no other God. Buddha, Confucius, none of them. They don't do miracles. Only God does miracles. He created man from the dust of the ground and made him in his image. And we know about Adam and Eve, the first Adam they called him. Then God sent his only son Jesus in the form of man. And we know we call him the second Adam. But the difference between the two is that Adam decided to die with his bride, whereas Jesus died for his bride. That ought to be reason enough to shout right there. He died for his bride. Because who's the bride? We are. That's me. I'm the bride, believe it or not. Did you see me at the bride? What a reason to know this Jesus. What a reason for the season. Because this is the reason for the season. It's December. It's Christmas. You know, his birth, the very birth of Jesus was a miracle. We all know about the Virgin Mary. As a matter of fact, his birth, his death, and resurrection was a miracle. It was a miracle. John 3:16 says that, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth on him should not perish, but have everlasting life. The key word is believe. You have to believe. That's the only way to get your miracle. You know, turn to Mark 6. It wasn't on forward, but just turn there. Mark chapter 6. We're going to read verse 1 through 6. You know, Jesus took his ministry back home. He took his ministry back home to Nazareth, and he brought his disciples with him. Mark chapter 6, starting in verse 1. It says, and he went out from thence and came into his own country, and his disciples followed him. And when the Sabbath day was come, he began to teach in the synagogue. And many hearing him were astonished, saying, from whence has this man these things? And what wisdom is this which is given unto him, that even such mighty works are wrought by his hand? That means Jesus was doing miracles. And they heard about the miracles. They saw the miracles. But verse 3 says, is not this the carpenter, the son of Mary, the brother of James and Jose and of Judah and Simon? And are not his sisters with us? And they were offended at him. Now Jesus came performing miracles, signs and wonders. Everywhere else, he was a superstar. When he came home, the very people that he thought would look up to him, his kinfolk, friends, relatives, were offended by him. You know, I heard Pastor James said a couple of Sundays ago that you're going to get hurt. Sometimes in life you will get hurt. But when you do, most of the time, it's from the one that's closest to you. The one that's closest to you is the one that's going to hurt you. You know, familiar with Jesus. You know, just because they hung out. You know, me and Brother Ronell, you know, we used to hang out back in the day, doing our thing, you know, sipping on the buzz or whatever. But today is a new day. Today is a new day. You know, we cannot get so familiar with someone that we can't receive from. You know, they were so, what they figured, they were so familiar with Jesus because he walked with them that they couldn't receive from him. But yet, this was the Son of God. This was the very man that held their miracle in their hand. But they couldn't receive because of unbelief. Remember, the key word is believe. Believe in miracles. You know, when I first got saved many years ago, I went back to my friends. And how many of you know when you go back to your friends once you've been saved, they really don't like the idea that you're saved? You know, they remember the old you, and they're ready to get down. You know, like, they'll say, Big Dave, remember when we used to? Anybody ever say that? Remember when you used to? Yeah, you're right. I used to. But now, I'm serving the God Almighty. I'm serving the God with power. You know, Paul says, when I was a child, I spake as a child. I thought as a child. I understood as a child. But when I became a man, I put away childish things. 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. That old me, rock, that old me passed away, is dead. Behold, all things are become new. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. John 14:11 says, believe me that I am in the Father and the Father in me, or else believe me for the very work's sake. In other words, I'm hearing that. To me, Jesus is saying, if you don't believe me that I am in the Father and the Father is in me, then believe me for the things that you saw me do. I know you saw me feed the 5,000. Besides men and women and children. I know you've seen me raise the dead, heal the sick. Believe me for the things that you saw me do. No man can perform those miracles unless God be with him. No man can perform those miracles unless God be with him. Acts 2:22 says, the men of Israel, hear these words. Jesus of Nazareth, a man approved of God among you by miracles, signs, and wonders. You know, it says, which God did by him in the midst of you, as you yourself also know. So God approved Jesus. I was listening to that. In other words, God endorses him. You know, that's God's guy. You know, you ever been, you know, I know Brother Eric can relate. You know, when you go to a business and you got a representative come in and you know he's endorsed by this certain company. He has all the power. Just ask him whatever and he'll get it for you. This is Jesus. God endorsed him. God endorsed Jesus. He was able to do these miracles, signs, and wonders. You just have to believe on him. Receive him. Amen? You know, sometimes we have, a lot of times we get in our own mind a perception of how, I guess how we want God to do the miracle. We want it done how we think and how it's, we think it's normally done. Turn to 2 Kings chapter 5. 2 Kings chapter 5. And this is a very familiar passage of scripture. It's talking about Naaman. Verse 1 says, now Naaman, a captain of the host of the king of Syria, was a great man with his mouth and honorable, because by him the Lord had given deliverance of Syria. He was also a mighty man in valor, but he was a leper. He was a leper. And the Syrians had gone out by companies and had brought away captive out of the land of Israel a little maid. She was waiting on Naaman's wife. And she said unto her mistress, would God, my Lord, were with the prophet that is in Samaria, for he will recover him of his leprosy. Now, look at this late Naaman. This was a mighty man of valor. I'm going to say a captain, general maybe, of the army, Syrian army of Aram. Now, he had all this prestige and, you know, all this going for himself. And the way the Bible talks like he was rich. And he was well respected by the king. But he was a leper. He was a leper. And we all know what the Bible says about leprosy. You know, I don't think that the Syrians, the Arams, did it the same thing that the Israelites did to separate themselves from the people. But this is something that we know that would take him down. So this maid that was from Israel told Naaman's wife that she knows somebody that can heal him of his leprosy. Now this woman was out of place. She was in a foreign country. So that goes to tell me that no matter where you are right now, God can still use you. You might not like the job that you own, but God might have you there for a reason. He might have a word, you might have a word for the people on your job. I know sometimes I wonder about my job. Man, why am I here? Lord, when you gonna take me off this job? But I realized that, you know, God has me there for a reason. You know, every shift, my shift, I don't let my guys go out without reading the scripture to them. You know, and sometimes we get caught up in, and if I don't read the scripture, they'll be like, what's the word for the day? You know, then I think about it, maybe that's why God has me on the job. For a word, to give a word to these people. A delivering word. So this lady, this was a little Israelite girl. You know, she didn't have to tell Naaman's wife about how he can get healed. She could have been feeling herself, oh, they got me over here, they done captured me. I'm not telling nothing. I hope his fingers fall off. But she knew that God had something for her in that place. She was used by God in that particular time. And verse 4 says, and one went and told his lord, saying, thus and thus said the maid that is of the land of Israel. The king of Syria said, go, and I will send a letter unto the king of Israel. And he departed and took with him 10,000 silver, 6,000 pieces of gold, and 10 changes of raiment. And he brought the letter to the king. Now he did all this here because Naaman wanted to be healed. You know, he was going to bring gold. The king wanted healed too, so he wrote a letter. Even though he wrote it to the wrong man, you know, we don't have to go there, but he wrote it to the king. Now, the king got all scared because, you know, I can't heal nobody. Why are you sending me this letter? I'm not God, you know, so he must be trying to pick a fight with me. But the man of God heard what the king was going through, that he rent his clothes. So the man of God, Elijah, told him, send him on over. Send him on over to my house. And then he'll know that there's a God in Israel. There's a prophet in Israel. Amen? So Naaman got his crew, his entourage, and he showed up at Elijah's house. So he got in his mind that, hey, this man is going to come out and do his thing. I'm going to be healed. So Elijah saw that he was there at his door. He sent his servant out. He told his servant, go out and tell him to go wash in the Jordan 7 times, and he'll be healed. Disrespect. So Naaman comes and stands there, and here comes a servant telling him to go wash in the Jordan 7 times. So I'm looking at thinking about Naaman. Now this is a captain. Did you tell him it was me? He know it was me. Brother Rob, ain't no way. It's no way that he told him it was me. Because he sent a servant out. Not only did he send a servant out, he told me to go wash in this mud pit. I know there's plenty of waters that's better than this in Damascus. Farpar, they call it, and some other clean spring. That's better than this mud pit. I dare him. I thought for sure he would come out and lay hands on me and call on the Lord, and then I'll be healed. Putting God in the box again. You know, sometimes God don't want to operate the way we think he operates. I've heard that God works in mysterious ways. You know, just because you heard him do it, heal someone this way one time, it may not be the way he want to heal them somebody else the next time. Because it's God. He does what he wants. Now this Naaman, he had been put God in the box. So Naaman's servant, that respected him so well, said, Father, if he would have told you to do something hard, would you not have done it? Now, if he told you to go climb up this mountain to show your mightiness, you'd have did it. So Naaman thought about it. You know what? Hey, you right. You right. So he went and dove into the mud pit and dipped 7 times. And the Bible said after the 7th time when he came up, his skin was as the skin of a child, a baby. Only if he only believed in the word. You know, we can't put God in the box. We got to take God out of the box because he wants to do so much for us, especially in this our season of miracles. He wants to do so much for us, but we got to take him out of the box. We don't know how he's going to do it. You know, just because we don't have the resources. You know, we can't say, well, I ain't going to get it. I don't even have resources. But if you had the resources and it happened, then you would think it's you anyway. That's how God operates. He wants to make sure man is totally out of picture. Then he does his work to show that he's God, the only true and living God, the God of wonders, the God that worketh miracles. I hear God saying that he wants to give us our miracle, but he's waiting on us to get rid of our excuses. But sometimes we can come up with some excuses. Well, if my husband was acting right, or if my wife was acting right, if I had a better job, if I had more money, then I would be able to do it. You know, that brings me to my next thing, John chapter 5. Turn with me real quick. I'm not going to be that long, people. John chapter 5. I just want to get it out. We have to believe God. Believe in miracles. But this is our season. And this is another familiar passage of scripture. And to make it go quicker, I just paraphrase it. And we know that this is the story of the man at the pool of Bethesda. Now it says that Jesus was walking through the town. It was the feast time. And he stopped by the pool of Bethesda. But Pool of Bethesda has five porches. And in those, within those porches, you know, the lame, blind, halt, all those type of lame people, they lie there waiting on the moving of water so they can step in the water and be healed. Because, you know, it was believed, even though I believe it was just a spring up under the water that, you know, stirred up and made the water, disturb the water. They believed that a certain time of year that the water would get disturbed, would bubble up, and an angel would come and stir that water up, and the first one to step in would be made whole. So Jesus saw this man who had been there for 38 years. I says he had an infirmity, 38 years. And Jesus, seeing him, went up to him and asked him, "Wilt thou be made whole?" The man didn't say, "Well, yes, I will be made whole." He made up an excuse. He said, "Well, sir, I have nobody when the water is stirred up to take me and put me in the water. Because before I can get there, someone else will step in before me." That's not what Jesus asked. Jesus wanted to know today, "Will thou be made whole?" That's what Jesus wants to know. And our answer should be yes. No more excuses. Even though this man, he had a legitimate excuse. But God don't want to hear the excuses. He just want to know, "Will thou be made whole?" You know, this man, reading and studying about this man, he wasn't a good man. You know, but he was just there because he was lame. Because the Bible says that Jesus told the man to pick up his bed and walk. He picked up his bed and walked. And he kept walking. In other words, he didn't say, "Well, thank you, dog. Oh, Lord, have mercy. I've been like this. Your name, Jesus, I've been like this for 38 years. Lord, thank you." He didn't say none of that. He just left, the Bible says. Went. And the Bible don't say nothing. It says Jesus called him later on, you know, when he was in the temple. I guess Jesus might have ministering and saw the man. Sinning. After he didn't got healed. Jesus had to tell the man, "Hey, stop what you're doing. Stop that. Before something worse come upon you." So this man, you know, if somebody told me that, you know, if somebody's speaking wisdom to you, sometimes you would take heed. But this man, he was like, "Who is this tip?" Like, he's looking at Jesus like, he don't smell right or something. I'm thinking, you know, see, this man just healed you, and you're out sinning again. You know, he didn't have the decency to say, "Well, okay, my bad, I'm sorry. I repent, I stop." He gets upset and he goes to the leaders and tell them, "Jesus, oh, the man you was talking about that told me to pick up my bed, there he is, his name Jesus. Go get him right there." This man, you know, this is how good God is. You know, and I know Jesus knew what type of man he was, but he healed him anyway. That's the grace, the compassion, the goodness of our God. That's how good God is. You know, who wouldn't want to serve a God, you know, like that? Full of compassion, full of mercy and everything, glory. This man didn't even have the dignity to thank the Lord. Hallelujah. This, I mean, I can go on and on, but I don't want to hold you. You know, we can't put God in a box. You know, we have to get rid of the excuses. You know, we have to get to the place to where, "God, I can't do it on my own. You know, I need you. I need help." You know, sometimes we think, you know, we get in a place to where, "I got to do this. Look at me, but I do it myself. I got to do that. My family, I need, I got to do this right for my family. I can't do it all. You know, I need help." You know, and as a man, you know, we feel a responsibility that we got to get this done. We got to get this done for our family. You know, we got to get these funds, get these ends, and we got to get this house or whatever we have to do, we have to do whatever it takes, you know, because we want to please our spouse, you know, we want to, you know, make our children happy, you know, we want to do all this, but if we do it all on our own, we wouldn't need God. You know, that's the power of God. That's how we know how good God is. You know, he takes the pressure off, you know, to where I can, you know, now I can sit back and know that I can't do it by myself. I need God. I need his mercy and his grace because I can't do it by myself. And he does. You know, I sit back and when I stop trying to do it on my own, with my own flesh, then I see him start working. Next thing you know, I'm seeing 15, 20 points, you know, finishing the game with 2 fouls. My wife cooking meals for me. Good meals that, yeah. There is a God. Man, you know, things just start turning itself around. You know, we just got to let it do it. Because this is our season, man. This is our season. We got to stay pumped up, man. The reason why I be so hyped, because, you know, I would treat y'all just like I treat my sons on the basketball court. Come on, Wayne, we got to get this thing together. It's time to go. It's time to move. We got to win this game. The thing is, we already know we won, but we just got to play it out. Huh? We just got to play it out. Hey, man, glory to God. Father God, I just thank you, God, for what you've done today, Lord God. We thank you, Lord God, that this is our season. This is our season for our miracle, Lord God. And Lord, we just want to thank you in advance. We give you praise, honor, and glory, Lord God, for the things that you are doing and the things that you have already done. We just give you praise, honor, and glory in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen and amen.